Welcome to the AHA Show,
where we hope to provide abundantly helpful advice through real stories of inspiration and achievement.
Hi, this is Jennifer Berman and my gorgeous co-host, Miss Alex Tu. And welcome to the AHA Show, where we provide abundantly helpful advice through real stories of inspiration and achievement. And with that, I have my dear friend, Louisette Geiss, that we are so thrilled to have on our show today. You have no idea. Louisette is a senior VP of a major title company. She's a mommy of four.
Yes.
And she has a story that is gonna provide a ton of aha moments for you, as she has touched my life so much.
Thank you.
I'm getting chills saying it because you've been the real deal. And you're just so supportive to me as a woman as well. And you're always there and you've always just been such a shining light. And I just can't thank you enough just for being the woman that you are. And we're so happy that you're a mommy of girls as well, because we've got to give back to our girls and our children. So Alex, you're a mommy as well.
Should we be crying already?
I'm crying already. Wait a minute.
I've been looking forward to this interview with you, Louisette, for a really long time. You are an inspiration. I'm the mommy of three girls, and I mean, we can get into it, but you've just paved the way so much, and your bravery, your courage. I mean, we just can't thank you enough for joining us today and giving us some of your aha moments.
Oh, well, thank you. I mean, honestly, the tears at bay. But truthfully, I don't, it's not every day that you get held up this much. So thank you, because it does actually help me keep going and persevering. And there's many a downtime and a challenging moment. So it's these kinds of moments that I try to tuck away, and when I go through those things, I just try to pull these up so that it can help push me forward.
Well, because there's so many haters that are out there too, and you tell a story what happened to you and with that. I mean, let's get into the story, but it's you've been taken away so much trying to fight with this Me Too movement and fight and do what's right. And it's finally happening in the entertainment industry, and it's trickling down into the real world, into the professional world as well. But you're a mommy, you're out there, you're trying to fight and bring in money too and work.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's where you have a real job, and I think we forget that sometimes.
Yeah.
You see people on TV, you see people fighting a movement. Well, guess what? Nobody's paying you to do that.
Nope.
So that's why you've got to have the deals that come through. That's why we, as women, we're trying to support you so much as well.
I look forward to that.
Yeah, I know, it's in the works.
Yeah. Please, yes.
So tell us, really, how did you get involved with this? What's your background in the entertainment industry?
Sure. So, I mean, I moved here when I was 21. I mean, I literally graduated college a year early, and I did want to be an actress and a producer and a director. And I really knew from a young age that was something that I wanted to do. And unfortunately, actually in high school, I had a best friend who passed away. And, it was that was one of my aha moments of saying, I know my parents kind of wanted me to be a lawyer. But I thought, God, I really want to be an actress and a director and be in the movie industry. So when she passed away, I realized, I better do what I want to do, truthfully. And so I literally, packed my bags, got on a plane. I really didn't know anybody here. I remember, walking out of the airplane being oh, God, I knew one girl, hope she shows up. She did show up, my friend Michelle, God bless her. And, that the rest is history. So I really hit the ground running. I was, I did very well in college. I studied my, tushy off. And when I came out here, I continued that. So I studied everything from writing, directing, producing. I was just talking to somebody recently about that. Really, if you want to make it, much like even in the real estate industry, you have to do many things and you have to provide value. So even as an actress, I didn't sit around. I would write my own shows. I would produce. And so it was very important to me. But what I kept coming up against was that I would actually booked my second job, which is rare, and I know that now. When I first started, I didn't realize it, but it was silk stockings, which, if we really want to date ourselves. Yeah. My brother pointed that out to me yesterday. I was like, oh my gosh. But
that takes you back.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. So, and look at that casting director was lovely, and I did that first job, and it was a very big part, and I was excited. But what started to happen was that I would go on different auditions, or I would go and I would be on a show, and I would literally be told, like, you know, see, you, we fired you because that girl would do what you wouldn't do.
Wow.
And it was very challenging for me. And I mean, the apex of the whole thing was meeting Harvey Weinstein, because I did become a writer, because I thought to myself, listen, you know, maybe if I don't be an actress, which in some ways, you know, there's this idea that that's much more of a needy position, you know, because you're going to put me in your show. But if I was a writer producer and I was bringing a script to your table,
something of
yes,
value.
that you know, listen, let me give you this, and I don't even care. I mean, I wanted to be in it, but I was like, yeah, let me walk away. I just still was part of something that I love to do. But at that meeting with Harvey Weinstein, which, you know, now unfortunately there's a lot of information about what transpired between he and I, and now I know how lucky I was. But, you know, in a nutshell, I met with him, and, you know, we had a great meeting. It was actually very difficult to get that meeting, so I was, like, really excited to get it. But then, you know, he excused himself, and he showed up back in nothing but a robe.
His typical.
Yes, yeah. And asked me to, you know, take care of him. I don't know how PC I have to be on your show, but
we'll have you met me?
Yeah,
I have. Stay tuned.
So
on that one. Exactly.
There's a whole nother show about that.
The Oprah show, honey.
But, you know, and in a nutshell, yes, he asked me to masturbate him. And he grabbed my arm, and, you know, I ripped my arm away, and I said, you know, this is ridiculous. And I was legitimately scared. And the thing is that what people need to understand is that, I mean, I had met him previous at the Cannes Film Festival, but I didn't know this guy. And to walk out in nothing, yeah, and tell me I have to do this for you, and that his energy and demeanor changed so much, yeah, I was legitimately scared. I feel like I'm a strong woman, but at the end of the day, like, I didn't know.
Scary.
Did he put something in my drink? Did he, you know, what? Can I get out of the door?
Right,
you know?
Exactly. Wow.
So I've learned a lot about trauma survivors now, and one of the things that they say is, like, yes, either you fight, flight, or...
That's
so
it.
I basically just tried to play nice. That's one of the other things. But I took my arm away, went out I was trying to get out of the room, and he followed me and said, listen, I can, you know, why are you doing this? Everybody does this. I can give you a 3-picture deal. You know, we'll make your movie. I'll introduce you to my brother, Bob. And, you know, I was like, this is so ridiculous. I got my stuff. He grabbed me to kiss me, and I got out. And when I got to the door, it was like one of those, you know, aha moments of, like, am I more of like a, and I opened the door, and it opened, and I got out. That was important. That just the fact that I was able to get out was that moment for me. Was, you have to understand, I had been in the business for 20 years. Okay, so by that time,
right?
And you know, because I did it in high school, even, right, you know, and I did it even in elementary school. This was something that I loved to do, but it really was that experience that made me feel like, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore. I love entertainment. I love making people happy. I love inciting them for change, or, you know, this is what I want to do. But I sure as hell don't want to be treated, quite frankly, you know, like some sex worker. You know, I'm here to do the job that I love as a writer and a producer and an actress. I'm not here to take care of you, if you will. So I decided really that I had to reinvent myself. And that was very hard, because it really was part of who I am. But you know what? I'm not into being treated poorly for the rest of my life. So I decided, you know, yes, I have to get out of it. And I did. I've evolved a lot. I mean, I was the person who owned a company used to say to my assistant, like, get off of Facebook, you know, and then I realized, oh no, that's
wait, that's stay all, on the
yeah,
Facebook.
That's
a whole career now. Twitter and Instagram.
Yeah, so I worked with an amazing woman, Liz Heller. She really helped hold me up. I learned social media. I worked with a lot of great big companies, you know, from Mark Friedland to Evite to the Oscars. So I felt very blessed. And then I really wanted to have a kid too. It's not so easy to date in this town. So I had met a little girl who needed a home, and it's a very long story, but I decided to become a foster parent. So wow. I became, as a single mom, talking about, you know, women supporting women, I helped this little girl, so women helping children, and I became her mom. And I needed a job that was a good company, that had good insurance. I wanted to be able to take care of her, you know, and I wanted to be able to focus on her and not bringing in work all the time. So I decided to stop owning my own company and work for a company. Okay. And you know, the rest is history. I do enjoy working in the real estate world. I'm in title, so I get to work with realtors all day long, and we all know how fun they are. Mm-hmm. And quite lovely people. I really do genuinely like my clients. Yeah. So I feel very blessed.
You have a family
now. Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you know, we all have to help each other, and I feel like this job enables me to have a great income and support my family and also work with like great wonderful humans. So
for those of us who don't know, is that you are, you know, coming out on top. You're the senior vice president of a top title company in the city, and I mean, it's just astonishing just how you've been able to really rebuild yourself.
Well, so, you know, as an actress or producer or a writer or social media, I've always been in sales, right? You have to be in sales. I was, before I was selling myself and my own company. So really, it was an easy transition. And I have to believe in the company that I work with. And this company, honestly, has always treated me so well. So I feel it's easy to sell them because I believe in the product. So I'm lucky to, you know, I work everything kind of hugging the ocean from Malibu all the way down to Westchester and then up into Brentwood area, Westwood. And again, you know, it's really just nice to work with genuine humans.
How long was it before you met Dave? Her husband, by the way, is an old friend of mine from years ago, and I didn't even know that, which was so funny. We were sitting at lunch, he walks in, I'm like, wait, what do you mean that's your husband? I'm like, Dave!
Well, who do you think recruited me into
I mean, he's the nicest, sweetest guy, so energy just like really comes with one another. So, I mean, like, how did, like, when did that come about?
Well, we met on Match.com, I will
did
tell you.
Did you really?
Yes, we did.
Well, they didn't meet in real estate.
No.
That is so trippy, and they're both in real estate. Okay.
Yeah, at the time, I was doing my social media. And then I was doing social media kind of for him and for, ironically, another title rep who you know well. Yeah. And I was at a big conference doing it, and I met somebody in escrow, this gal named Carrie, and she said, oh, why don't you come meet with us? And I did, and, you know, it was actually a pretty quick hire. So, and then I got recruited into title about 8 months later. So, yeah. But he was the one, he said, why don't you talk to my wife? I'm like, escrow, like, I mean, you know, it's very divergent from my old life, but the truth of the matter is that what I know, so as you know, realtors these days are always in front of the camera. So, you know,
what?
Lord knows I know about that. I can write well, and then I know everything from, you know, social media to sales. So, you know, it was a nice, seamless transition, so I'm lucky.
You know what I like that you said earlier is that Liz is the one that supported you and lifted you up.
Yeah,
because I mean, I'm sorry, but that's the problem in leadership with women. I've been hurt the most by women. Mm. And so you just don't know when that is, and you were so blessed to have another lady that really uplifted you, that had to make an impact on you after a predator came after you.
Oh yeah, no, she's really, she's the real deal. And she's helped so many women and men, of course, but you know, I literally did not know anything about social media. I mean, I was a very hard worker, but you know, that's a whole different language, you know. So she took me under her wing. She knew that I was going to be a foster mom soon, so that I needed that job in order to take that child. So it was really, you know, a beautiful thing. And again, listen, the title job kind of happened, and so I feel lucky that I had that before, because you know, it definitely helps.
I'm chomping at the bit right now. I have so you know, Jen, you've known Louisette. This is actually the first time I've ever met you, and so I have so many questions. First of all, you know, this is the AHA show.
Yes.
And you know, and really AHA moments, and I'm really curious, What, I mean, I remember reading about you in the New York Times. You were the one of the very first women to come out and actually put a spotlight on, and that was very, very difficult to do. What was it that made you, what was that moment, or can you describe it? What was that journey that made you make the decision to go public with this?
I think, you know, I had just had a baby when the whole story hit New York Times and the New Yorker. I mean, I've said this before, I literally was leaving the OBGYN when the for my six-week checkup. So, like, let me just say, the last thing I wanted to do at that time was to come forward about my experience with Harvey. I mean, really the last thing. But pretty quickly, obviously, the stories back-to-back, I think, corroborated what all of these women had experienced, and men, you know, quite frankly. So I went home that night, and I was with, I remember sitting in the living room with my husband. I got a little newborn, you know, breastfeeding a newborn, and I got a 1.5-year-old running around.
Three times.
You know, running around, yeah, and... I mean, we're just sitting there like, what the hell do we do?
Right.
Because I had already been contacted by a big news outlet already. Because I had told my story to actually a realtor just literally 3 weeks previous. And then she happened to know somebody. So it happened very fast that I started to, you know, be asked, hey, will you come speak with us? And so my husband and I are looking at each other like, well, he could, you know, counter sue us, or, you know, I mean, at that time, you have to know that. I mean, yeah, it was a very different landscape than it is just 2 years, not even 2 years later. So we sat there and he said, you know, why don't you call Gloria Allred?
Right.
I'm like, seriously, that lady's not going to call me back. Like, I mean, me? Anyways, I literally just contacted her via the internet. And she did call me back. So speaking of women, you know, who follow through and hold each other up. But she called me back, and then I told her my story. I really initially just wanted to tell her, because I wanted to corroborate what, like, Ashley Judd had said, you know, mm-hmm. because, again, there weren't many women who had put their face to mm-hmm. the experience. So I just simply wanted to say, listen, I want you to know this happened to me. But she said, I think you should come forward to help bring other women out. But it's important to know, though, that, like, I didn't have any legal representation at the time if he did countersue me. So when my husband and I sat in Gloria Allred's office and, like, did that, you know,
yeah.
I mean, we, you know, we've gone from an apartment to a home, but he bought homes
yeah.
years ago, and with, like, every inch of our being, we've held on to them, right?
Yeah.
And we've lived very minimally in order to
right.
do so. So to have the thought of, like, oh my gosh, now we could lose everything,
yeah.
literally lose everything.
And you have children.
Yeah.
That's the stuff that people don't think about.
No, they don't. They don't. Not at all.
Yeah.
Because when trolls say, like, I'm doing this for fame and money, I'm like,
oh, yeah, honey. I love that.
Oh, yeah.
First you don't
of all,
even know.
Yeah, there is no, there has been no money. And
yeah.
fame really, you know, does not make sense that I would have, you know, waited 8-9 years to become a women's advocate. You know, if I was the person who just did things for money,
right.
I would have taken Harvey
yeah.
up on his deal. I
right.
mean, why
right.
would I not make millions
exactly.
and millions and millions of dollars and have a 3-picture deal with something that I love to do? No, it was ridiculous. But so we decided as a couple, and he really did, you know, I always give him credit for this, because I know as a man it is not hard, not easy to stand by with all of what went on.
The scrutiny. Yeah.
Yeah, and he was there. He was literally standing next to the camera when we did the
Such
press conference. So he was, he did hold me up. And listen, you know, we're all not perfect, but God bless him, because at the end of the day, he was like, you know what, you got to do this, and I support you. And so we did. But no one knew. I mean, who the hell knew what was going to happen? I mean, I just simply thought, like, God, if we could just, like, do something for a week. Like, because it really bothered me what happened to me. I gave up my whole career. You know, it was very soul crushing. The behavior in the entertainment industry was so rampant. I mean, like,
yes.
literally every day. Every day to be treated, you know, like some kind of sex worker. It's just horrible.
Yeah.
And, you know, I didn't ask for that, you know. I mean, every day I shouldn't have to go to work and be treated that way. So it was important to me. And he did help hold me up. And I will say now we're doing a class action lawsuit against the Weinstein Company. So speaking of women holding each other up, I was lucky enough to meet Beth Fagan, who's doing a class action against the Weinstein Company. And She's a mom of five. She's really, truly phenomenal. I mean, honestly, you got to watch her work because she's really amazing. But anyways, we spoke and I became the lead plaintiff against the Weinstein Company. And why that's important, too, is because, again...
Wait, you're the lead plaintiff?
Yes, yeah. The lead plaintiff.
Oh, my goodness.
It always gives me a slight heart attack because it says Geiss versus Weinstein, and I'm like, But, you know...
That's a lot of responsibility. My husband is an attorney. He does class actions. And the reason why I kind of had a reaction to that, because the responsibility of the lead plaintiff is just so much more. I mean, they're grilling her, you, and looking at your background and everything. You're under scrutiny.
Yeah, absolutely.
And for you to do that, that's incredible.
Well, thank you. And I will take that because it isn't fun by any means. But, you know, the reason that I do it, and then we have many other women, many of whom I help bring to the table, and God bless them, many have put their names on it as well. And even those, you know, who are anonymous, I mean, I appreciate it because it truly takes a village to stop, a serial predator.
That's
and
right.
I mean, I think that what we're trying to do truly is to say to companies, it is more expensive to keep somebody like this hired and in working with you than it is to fire them and get rid of them. Because all these companies, they say, oh, well, he made us a lot of money. You know, and like I've been at the federal courtroom and heard these kinds of comments, and it's very challenging. I mean, it is just so important for everybody to know, like, look, if you see this happening, you got to stop it too. It's not just about one person. It's about the allowing it to happen. And what I know now is for 30 years.
I was about to say.
That's outrageous.
I've been in Hollywood for a long time. I can't even begin to tell you how many girlfriends I have had. We all have the stories of you going up there and him in the white robe in the hotel room. That's just a common story.
Yeah.
Everybody knows that. So when you have all these women that nobody had a voice, nobody could fight it, it is what it was.
Right.
And you know, the old casting couch actually is a real thing.
Yes.
And now it's like, it's all come to a screeching halt. You were talking about Beth a second ago.
Yeah. So, I mean, Beth, she is the lead lawyer on this case. And I mean, you know, she's the amount of work that she's done to put this together. I mean, literally, it's over 270 pages, our complaint. So, I mean, you have to understand this is no small feat, right? I honor her. I honor all the women who are stepping up because it isn't fun. There's zero fun in it.
Zero money.
Yeah.
Costs you money right now, actually.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think it is really important, though, that we say to corporations, really as a whole, look, you guys have to stop. You know, if somebody's doing this, then fire them and do some legal action and or jail. I mean, quite frankly, I think we would all agree that Harvey belongs in jail, not just fired, but, you know, jail.
Right,
but I mean, I think if we can stop that, my goal is like, look, I don't want my daughters or my sons, quite frankly, my stepsons to come home and say like, hey, this happened to me today. Because I don't want them to have my experience. I do want, look, you work hard, you do a good job, you show up, then you get that job.
That's it.
Okay? Not that you have to do some disgusting thing that they ask you to do in order to move your career forward. So I just hope that, you know, moving forward, nobody in any career, whether it be a class action lawyer, because I know we've all known other women and men, you know, quite frankly, it happens to men a lot too. I can't tell you how many men come up to me and they're like, oh my God, thank you. And you really got me to talk about what happened
to
me.
You know what? We were at an Inman event, and
yes,
that is exactly what happened. I was standing right there next to you, Luxury Connect, and a guy came up and said and shared a story, and I was like completely taken back.
Yeah, yeah.
You just don't think about those things.
Yeah, so I think that the Me Too movement, it was so meaningful because, so it wasn't just about, you know, just the what was happening at the workplace. It was about, you know, sexual assault everywhere.
Right, and, absolutely.
And I really, I mean, and I think that just brought on a whole conversation throughout the country. And I mean, even amongst my friends and, you know, people that I knew that I didn't know were sexually assaulted.
Mm-hmm.
And we all stepped forward and we told our stories. I mean, I can tell you I'm one of them.
And I'm one of them too. So and you put women in the room.
Three of us.
And I'm going to tell you right now, you've got about 90% that have stories like
that. I'd say 99.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
That is really
the power of what you started here is that, you know, it's now not taboo because there was so much shame in it. And really for us, like, look, we're three women and we just all three of us raised our hand and said, me too.
Yeah.
It happened to me too.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, that's really powerful. And one of the biggest things about the AHA show is giving helpful advice and really sharing your aha moments. But also, you know, it's about a show of women helping each other. And it's about, you know, Jen and I, we talk about this all the time. There's so many shows out there where women are pinned up against each other. They're fighting and it's just great entertainment to tear each other apart. And, you know, and so for us, you know, what's really important on this show is to bring to show like a different level of love, a different level of support, and you know, and how we go about doing that. And I think that, you know, what you're doing is absolutely amazing. I think that we all need to support Louisette. If you're in real estate, you need to look up her name right
Thank
now.
You, please. Yeah.
it's so. You know, there's so many different things that bring this up, and I'm gonna turn this around a little bit differently.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, as well. Because, you know, I've ran companies and, you know, I've headed up with HR and I've done these things. And I am a young leader, you know, I'd still like to think of myself a little young, okay, you know, but as I was growing in my 30s, I was a young leader and as a manager. And, you know, I clearly, you know, coming in my 20s, you know, hot rocks and getting out and going to Vegas and doing these, you know, speaking events and, you know, having fun and drinking and stuff. I mean, you're in your freaking 20s. Thank God for YouTube, honey. I wouldn't have a career today, probably. But, you know, it wasn't back then is what I'm saying. The point being is, I always was strong enough. If the heat's too hot in the kitchen, get out of the kitchen.
Yeah.
And I've always been a person that could stand up for myself. Mm-hmm. And if you do this. Now, what you said in that situation, I've been in that situation though. They're coming at you full force.
Yeah.
So you don't have that opportunity standing at in a office setting or at a bar or something to like not be scared like that. That's a whole different when you're in that. And I've been in that situation. And what happens is you don't know how to respond because you're in shock on it.
Yes.
Do you go nice? Do you, I mean, you don't know what they're gonna do.
Right.
I mean, you know, or do you, it's just, it's an awkward, horrific experience and one that you never forget and reaches you to the core. I think where I'm also going with that, on the same token, I've seen some of these girls And I've had it happen recently at an old company that I manage. So you don't invite something and have that intent and then flip it around on somebody when the man's thinking that you're playing that game with them.
Mm-hmm.
So there also is a token, we've got to do the Me Too movement. My God, of course we do. We've got to stop these predators. But on the same token, I just want women to also know it's not okay to just to take everything so literal that a man's saying. I mean, come on, man. I mean, there's one thing about personal space. But when somebody's being authentic and genuine and they're a good man, they're a good person, you know that about them, let's not also take it to that level either. I mean, you know, how...
I think first and foremost, for we as women, whether you like it or not right now, have a huge responsibility.
Yeah.
And we have the responsibility of being very, very, very honorable. So when if you are the kind of person who's thinking, well, you know, with this movement, now I can say this or that and get my way and make money, that is not honorable. And it does not help what we're trying to do.
Right.
What we're trying to do is, look, you know, I'm not trying to stop any relationship. I'm not trying to, you know, or people having sex. Like one guy said to me, you know, your whole movement is stopping men and women from, you know, getting together. That is not the case, okay? What I am trying to do is say, look, if I'm going on a job interview or whatever it is, or even a date, look, be respectful. This is a very simple concept that I would like to, you know, use myself. You know, I'm not going to ask a guy to do something that I would feel makes him uncomfortable as well.
Right.
So for all of us, men and women, and listen, you know, we were just having this conversation over there that, yeah, men have said like, well, should I do this or that? I'm sorry it makes everybody a little uncomfortable, but you know what?
It's time.
It's time.
Yeah. It's been so bad this way that the pendulum's going to swing this way. And then at some point, we're all going to like get a little bit more human and go, okay, this feels good right here in the middle. And, you know, look, I love men. I love my husband, my boys, my dad. I have no issue with that. But I do have an issue with asking anybody to do a sexual act in order to move your career forward. Right. And I've said this many times. I can't even believe I have to say that.
Right.
Like, it's really kind of just so stupid.
Right. I mean, this is
why
like so ABC.
But it also goes back to, you know, knowing that when a woman tells you something, and I mean, it's hard to talk about this stuff.
Oh, absolutely.
You gotta believe her.
Yeah, there's
know?
Definitely.
And there's gonna be the ones, or you know, the ones that are gonna spoil the entire, you know, apple basket.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, but there's far more women that are not being believed.
And I agree with that. I mean, I think for the most part, people have asked me how many of these women that I've met. Do I think are telling the truth? And in all honesty, I truly believe, you know, maybe there is a 0.001%
right.
that are not telling the truth. And to them, shame on you.
Right.
Shame on you.
That's
Don't
right.
do that. Because we are trying to make this world a better place.
That's it.
But to the 99.9% of the women, you know, I hear you. I believe you. And look, let's create a new reality. That's what I say. Create a new reality for men and women. And quite frankly, I do believe, like, eventually relationships are going to do better because
I agree.
Yes.
Because for me, even, I mean, I, you know, I had to go through all these traumatic events, like before, you know, even getting married to my husband. Now we take that with us.
Right.
If we now are creating a generation where men and women, like, you don't even have to think about it. Yeah. I would never ask a girl to do that. Or I would never, you know, say yes to that as the female, you know, now we're actually giving, hopefully my hope is like a much more even playing field of love and peace and just comfortability, quite frankly. So you're not going on your first date already angry because of the 7 things that happened to you before. You know?
Well, and as mommies, that's kind of what I ask you guys with girls, quite frankly. I mean, you know, do your girls talk to you about this and ask you questions about this? Because they see you doing interviews on TV.
Yeah, I mean, mine are so small. They're 3.5 and 1.5. But I will say, you know, my 3.5 is really getting a lot more now, and she has seen me on TV. And I just flew to Australia to speak there about this subject, but actually at a real estate conference. And I wrote a little book about it, and I, you know, I used a crayon because one of my friends, one of my good friends teaches trauma classes, Louise Godbold, and she does parenting classes. And I called her. I was like, "What should I do? I feel bad, kind of even going." And she said, "Look, here's one of the tips I would say is to like create your own book." And one of the pages of that book says, "Mommy's going to talk to many women and men and try to inspire them and hold them up to, you know, make the world a better place." So, I mean, she is getting that now already. And my mom, God bless her, and my dad, both, they always helped. We were volunteering from, like, seriously, I think it was age 4. I mean, you must volunteer in my household. So they raised me that way. And I think if I can give that back to my kids, you know, so whether you have no money or a lot of money, you are still a good, decent human being,
right.
I think is the key, you know.
Right. Did you not fall in love with Louisette? Now you see why we love you so much. I can't even begin. Alex and I I just have chills. So thank you so much. You're so important to all of us as women. And it's just such an inspiration and such a support. And we just need more ladies and more mommies like you both, ladies.
Well, and thank you to you, because like your perseverance is it's really inspirational. Seriously. I actually quoted you when I was in Australia. I had a very tough day and I said, but Jen Berman would do it. So if she could do it, I'm going. I'm going to do it. So anyways, I honor
you.
Thank you. Thank you. And
thank
I look forward to getting to know you better.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Love you both, girls. And thank you for our aha moment show.
When life throws you for a loop, just remember, you are stronger and more capable than you realize. So it's time for you to say aha and realize it too. Thank you so much for joining us.
And if you're smelling what we're cooking, please hit subscribe and like. Bibiana Berman needs to eat.